immediately following the services. And I'm going to ask if you would just to go ahead and take your seats as we further this service. And we will definitely have opportunity to greet the family and show our love and our respect to them immediately following the services. Thank you so much. And I appreciate your following through with that. The Psalm 122nd Psalm says, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. We have just transformed Murphy's Fine Arts Auditorium into a sanctuary. And we are here to celebrate the life of our loved one. And I think you ought to put your hands together and let's celebrate Coach Frazier. Come on, put your hands together for the life well lived. I think you can still do a little bit better than that for a life well lived. Husband, father, grandfather, uncle. Amen, 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 amen. We are here to celebrate. We are here to celebrate. There is an oxymoron that appears in scripture, and there's a lot of scripture that seems to be an oxymoron from time to time. But in Matthew's gospel in the 5th chapter, it says, blessed are those who mourn. And the question becomes, how can you be blessed and mourning at the same time? But the scripture further reads, because they shall be comforted. And that is that there is a God assignment for those who have mourning in their lives. So our prayer is with the family and loved ones of this great man of God. And we pray that you would continue to pray for one another. Amen? Oh, that didn't quite sound like a church. I said, this is a sanctuary. I said, amen? Amen. There you go. Amen. At this time, we're going to have a musical selection by Kia Pearson. And we're going to ask that she just give her hand as she comes at this time. Kia.
Praise the Lord, everybody. May the Lord comfort this family. Amen. Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, let me stand. I am tired, I am weak. Precious Lord, take my hand, precious Lord, and lead, Lord, 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 lead me.
Thank you, Ms. Pearson. Awesome, awesome selection. Let's look to the Lord. Father, if we've ever needed you before, we sure do need you now. Kind Father, we come to you now asking you to allow your presence to strive with us. For you said in your word that you would be with us. Lo, I'm with you always, even until the end of the age. And so, God, we thank you so much for the life of Coach Frazier. We thank you for the legacy that he's had through the years and the impact he's had on our lives. But now, God, that he's with you, we need your strength. And so, God, we pray for this family. We pray that you would give them strength and that you would also comfort them. God, cause the lessons that he's taught, cause the impact that he's had to be one that is eternal and lasting. Thank you, God, that even as he's gone on to heaven, that his mantle has not gone with him. But Lord, who he has been and how awesome he's been, and the impact he's had on others is still here on earth. And we're grateful, Lord, that when we look for him, that we can find him in his darling wife. We can find him in his sons. We can find him in his grandchildren. And we thank you for these things. And we pray, God, that you will continue to give this family strength and comfort them in the days that are ahead. And we glorify you for the same. In the matchless name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Let every heart say amen. At this time, we're going to have our scripture reading, and we're going to ask if Sister Stephanie Whitfield would come and read our Old Testament scripture of Psalm 23, and following her, our Sister LaDonna Bush, who will read the New Testament scripture out of 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 7 and 8.
Psalm 23, the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest the table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil. My cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen.
Second Timothy chapter 4, verse 7 and 8. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept my faith. Henceforth, there is laid up before me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day. And not to me only, but unto them also that love his appearing. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 7 and 8.
This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. At this time, we will have a musical selection by our sister Anitra McKinney, and she will be accompanied by Dr. Eric Conway. Come on, give them a hand as they come.
Oh,
This time we're going to have a special presentation on behalf of this fine institution. And aren't you glad to be at Morgan State University? I think we ought to put our hands together right there. Murphy's Fine Arts Auditorium. At this time, there's a presentation on behalf of the university.
Good morning. On behalf of President Dr. David Wilson, Athletic Director Dr. Edward Scott, Morgan State University would like to give condolences to the entire Frazier family. The President has asked that I read this citation for Mrs. Alice Frazier and family. The Morgan State University community and I wish to extend a heartfelt sympathy during your hour of bereavement and the recent passing of your beloved husband, Coach Nathaniel Frazier. May your faith sustain you and bring you strength and peace. Weep but briefly for your loved one as he enters into the kingdom of God, for he shall possess a joy and peace that is unattainable on God's earth. Rather, rejoice in his everlasting and total happiness, for his eyes have seen God. Given under my hand and seal of Morgan State University, the first day of October, in the year of our Lord, 2019, Dr. David Wilson.
Put our hands together for Morgan State University once again. The niece of Coach Frazier is coming now, Rachel Frazier, with thank yous and acknowledgments. And please know that she will read a few, but the family will, at a later time, go through everything that has been sent. But there have been a few that have been selected just for our public hearing today. Amen? Amen.
Good morning. The family of late Nat Frazier wishes to acknowledge the many expressions of sympathy and gestures of kindness shown to us following our loss. We offer heartfelt thanks to the families, friends, neighbors, and well-wishers who visited, brought food, or provided emotional or practical support for us during this difficult time. For those who telephoned, traveled long distances, sent floral tributes, cards, and messages of condolences, as well as those who made charitable donations, we are truly grateful. A special word of thanks to the management and staff of Evergreens at Columbia Town Center and the friends and neighbors there who have shown such great kindness and support to the family. We'd also like to thank Morgan State for their support and their recognition of Nat Frazier. So. Coach Frazier was known and respected by so many people for his expertise as a basketball coach and for his ability to uplift others, especially the young players and former students. Please know that my prayers are with you as you seek solace and peace during this time. Elijah E. Cummings, Representative, 7th District of Maryland. From the Office of the State's Attorney, Nathaniel Nat Frazier will be remembered not solely for his passion and for his commitment and determination to be a positive example for his family, his players, and his community. Please accept our deepest condolences on this first day of October, 2019, Marilyn Mosby, State's Attorneys. From the city of Baltimore, I, Bernard C. Jack Young, mayor of the city of Baltimore, do hereby extend my heartfelt sympathies to the friends and family of this beloved and valued citizen. At this difficult time, please know that our thoughts and our prayers are with you, and hope the love and support from those closest to you provide comfort in the challenging days ahead. From the City Council of Baltimore, be it hereby known to all that the City Council of Baltimore extends its sincere sympathy to the family of Nathaniel Frazier. The entire membership offers its respectful condolence and directs this resolution be presented on this first day of October 2019. So I'll share just a couple of cards we've received from friends. Still with you are so many memories to help you through every tomorrow. Still with you are so many people who share in your loss and your sorrow. Thank you, Elizabeth Poinsett. Liz, with sympathy, we do not grieve without first loving. We do not love without gaining more than we could have ever lost. So sorry for your loss, Mr. Ben Dent. Through love, through friendship, a heart lives more than one life. We will remember a life fully lived, filled with laughter and love. Thank you for your kind words and your support for this family. May God bless you and your families.
Let's put our hands together for one another. For all of you who have shown love to this family, thank you so much. Your presence means the world to them. There's a story in the Bible in John's Gospel, the 14th chapter, that is kind of confusing. There's a guy by the name of Philip. A lot of the disciples that follow Jesus prove not to be sitting in the front of the classroom. And Philip asks Jesus, he says, I want to see the Father. He says, I want to see the Father. And he says, if it suffice, let me meet him. And Jesus' response to Philip is, if you've seen the Son, you have already seen the Father. I want to introduce to you now the sons of Coach Frazier. Put your hands together for Kevin and Kenny Frazier as they come.
Good morning, everyone. I want to thank everyone for coming today. Let you know we really appreciate you showing up. My father would be really proud of all the people here in the stands today, because hopefully he touched someone's life in here. And he'd just be proud of the accomplishments and how wonderful everyone looks today and in good health. So we really appreciate you showing up.
He'd also probably have a story about everybody.
That's true.
He might shed a tear or two because that's the way he was, but he would be so happy that his guys, his people, the folks from Morgan, the folks from Bowie, the folks from the Evergreens, people from his college, people even from his high school, are here to celebrate his life. And he would also say, we are here to celebrate my life, so let's celebrate, and let's make sure we have a good time. Tell lots of stories, talk about them. He enjoyed it, whether he was listening to his music out on the porch, right?
That's right.
Or whether he was here at Morgan, or he was down playing Rummy Q with his crew from the Evergreens, right?
Right, or riding over to the mall on a scooter.
Right. He loved to interact with people, so please make sure that you have a good time today and honor his legacy. So, yeah.
So now I'd like to introduce Kennedy Frazier, his grandson. He spent a lot of time with Kennedy as he started a little boy playing football, basketball. I coached him, and I think he was there to watch me to make sure I was coaching properly.
Right.
But Kenny and him spent a lot of time together, and he was so proud of his grandson, and he followed him everywhere he went, from middle school to high school to college. And he was proud of all his grandchildren. But Kennedy had a special part in his heart, and He's going to give a poem right now.
Good morning. Shortly after my grandfather's passing, I wrote a little reflection to myself about our experience together. Papa, where do I start? Do I begin with trips to Disney and my first experiences riding go-karts? You flooded me with books as a kid, making sure I got a good read. Spending weekends over your house, we ate our favorite meal together, Frank's and beans. I didn't choose to carry the family sport tradition, but I set out the same mission and made efforts to live by those methods of a strong work ethic. You were a big influence to many, as you can tell. If you could get a ring for how many lives you've impacted all day long, we'll hear that bell. With technology, you were so advanced, and every day you woke up, you made sure your shirt and shoes matched your pants. You made me embrace all the many accomplishments I have done, the way you bragged about your grandson. No matter the room I walked in, you would call me by the name, Ken Ken, Kenny, or Kevin. You were there for many game days and every graduation. I knew at an early age from your coaching persona the importance of preparation. It was hard to picture this day would come because you were so full of life. To a dark world, your humor and charisma was like a shining light. God made an attempt calling you home earlier than your expiration date. Battling illnesses for years, you fought back for a good sake. Some things may change, but one thing that will remain the same is the fact that I am proud to have your last name. Love you, Pop Pop.
Good job, Kennedy. And by the way, you know, he loved to go see Kennedy played football at Toledo. And so coach would love to go see him play. And so Kenny would have to rent a car and they'd all drive out to Ohio.
Yeah.
And the rides were amazing because, as you know, Nat loved to stop.
Yeah, he stopped lots of times. He knew where he wanted to eat, how long he wanted to eat, when we were supposed to get gas. And I said, Dad, remember, we got to get someplace.
And I think that, like, all the players here remember that if there was one man who loved a buffet,
it was
my father. Y'all know. I see Troy over there laughing. He knows. When we first got here in the early 70s, there was just a dirt road out in front of Hurt Field, Hurt Gymnasium. And the basketball games were played inside that gymnasium. And it's amazing because some of the guys from that first team are here today. And some of the people that have been here for this entire journey, his entire journey at Morgan, are here today. And it is unbelievable as I walked over there yesterday and looked at that building and remembered the memories that were created inside that little gymnasium, how it used to rock. And how they used to have to lock the doors because so many folks would try to get into the games. It was bananas. And it was a different time and a different era and the height of black college basketball. And one of the folks that is here today has been here. He never left. What, he had like a 2 days between graduation and then time he took off?
Yeah, no
vacation. Right, he graduated and then took his job here at Morgan and never left.
Nope. So I want to introduce Joe McGiver. He is the Senior Associate Athletic Director here at Morgan State in class of 1974. He's been here through the beginning, and let's give him a well welcome applause.
First, given all honor and praises to my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Honor to the
ministry here on the stage. And all blessings to the Frazier family. I didn't introduce myself before. My name is Joe McIver. I'm the Senior Associate Athletic Director here at Morgan State University. And I was here when Nat first came here on campus. I was a sophomore basketball player. And I remember him coming on campus, and Chet Davis, myself, and Phil Pugh, we decided to go to his office to see who this new basketball coach was. Well, wasn't a good meeting for me because I was a 6'4", 160-pound guard who liked to run up and down the court and get away from everybody. But Nat Frazier said, nope, we're going to play a half-court offense, and you're going to stand still, and you're going to have to be able to hold off all these big guys. So I did what I had to. But Nat, you know, he played a special part in my life. The team that we had during that time, we were from all over the place. We had guys from Virgin Islands, Houston, Texas. We had guys from the Midwest, Cleveland, Pittsburgh, Illinois. We had New Yorkers, and I mean, we had New Yorkers. They were from Brownsville, Bedford-Stuy, Elmsford, and then, of course, we had Baltimoreans. Yes, sir. And even though we all spoke English, we all spoke a different dialogue. And the only one that could understand what everyone was saying was Nat Frazier, because when he spoke, everybody shut up. You know, if you watch television and watch all these national announcers, they're going to tell you that Paul Westphal and Phil Jackson invented the triangle offense. That's not true. We ran the triangle offense back in 1971. It was called Illinois. It was our signature offense. And Nat had it down to a T on how we would run it. And it was an offense where you would throw the ball into the post, and then you would cut off the post. But you didn't just cut off of the post. You had to do it Nat's way. You had to do a jab step. You had to do special things, and Nat taught each and every one of us how to do it. Because if you didn't do it, guess where you sat at? Ask me about it, I know. He taught us how, on defense, the out-of-bounds line was your second defender, and never let anyone go down the baseline. He taught us the little things. We had an All-American center, but it was the other guys that he had to mold. He had to mold them in a special way so that we played as a team. He always talked about how we were a family, and that was important to him. You know, a lot of people would say that he had a temper. And actually, what he really was doing was fighting for his players. People didn't realize that. And I have to say, I didn't realize it either. See, I had the opportunity not only being a player for Nat Frazier, but I also had the opportunity to work with Nat Frazier. And when I started working as the sports information director, probably my second year as SID, he took me to lunch, and he kind of explained everything to me. And it was so plain. I didn't know that Coach Frazier was brought up in the Deep South during the Jim Crow era. He had a tough time. And because of that tough time, he wanted to protect his players. He wanted to protect his family. He didn't want them to go through the things that he went through. And that was where his focus was. That was where his love was. That was why he sometime would go off and freak out on the basketball court. I remember a couple times where he was kicked out of the game and he refused to leave the game. We didn't understand it, but, you know, as time went on and I got to know Nat better and I got to know him as a co-worker, he would explain things a lot deeper to me, he would say to me things when I was a worker with him that he couldn't say when I was a player. And I got the opportunity to really respect the man. Actually, For anyone who's seen my father looks just like Nat Frazier. You wouldn't be able to tell the difference. Only one is about 3 inches taller. But they were the same type of person. They went through a lot of things during their younger years that a lot of people didn't understand when they got to meet him later on in life. Nat touched my life in some ways that maybe he never even understood. But I appreciate him for taking the time out to talk to me and to just let me know that everything's going to be all right. Because when he was here, I never thought I would be here for 45 years. Been an employee for Morgan State University for 45 years, and if I make it to 2020, we'll be in here, undergrad and employee for 50 years. But I owe a lot of that to Coach Frazier, because Coach Frazier would sit me down sometime when times were getting rough, when the school wasn't giving me the support that I thought that I needed, and he would explain to me how I had to fight on, because that's what he did in 1971, in 1972, 1974, the entire time he was at Morgan. He had to fight for his basketball team because the school didn't support him the way he thought we should be supported. We won a national championship in 1974. I remember we came back to Baltimore and it was just like it was another day on campus. Nat didn't like that. So he went out, he talked to the mayor of Baltimore City and a lot of local officials, and they had an affair for the basketball team. They did a commercial with the basketball team in it. That's the type of person that he was. He wasn't going to let you hold him back from the things that he thought were right. I appreciate him. Alice, Kenny, Kevin, I thank you for sharing Nat Frazier with us. And I want you to know that you have a family of young men who are always going to be there, and know that Joe McIver is only a phone call away. Thank you. God bless you.
Joe, I wish he had had that same conversation with some of the officials he yelled at, though. They could have. They need it. Right? Yeah. You know, I cover a lot of different people. One of the people I cover, Tiffany Haddish, she coined the phrase that she's the black unicorn. And it's funny when she said that, I was like, actually, I know the original black unicorn. And if you played at Morgan State after 1976, you heard about the black unicorn, that mythical, perfect point guard who everyone, after he left Morgan, had to live up to. There was something special about the relationship between Nat and Billy Newton. He could almost read his mind, and it brought a calmness, an ease to him at times, because he knew that the things he wanted executed, Billy could execute those things. And he would do it in a flawless way. He could always look over Nat, and even if Nat was losing his mind a little bit, he knew what to do. He's like, I got this. I know what we're doing. We're running Illinois. We'll go through rotation. I got this. And it would calm him down. So I feel like Tiffany Haddish really stole your name, because you are one of the, in Nat's eyes right now, if there was an NBA draft, Billy Newton should be drafted before Steph Curry, because he could do more things. He was a great player here at Morgan, and he has been a great man. And every day of my life, I listened to Billy Newton's stories, and so that's why so often when I began to play basketball, I was like, oh, I gotta play like Billy Newton. And I just told him in the hallway, even to this day, they tease me at work that I don't put lotion on my elbows and hands, and I said, because Billy Newton told me in 1974 in the Baltimore Civic Center, don't put lotion on before a game. Somehow that became a habit that never happened again. And that's a situation. But he is someone that Nat loved so deeply, and he meant the world to him.
So I'd like to introduce Mr. William Billy Newton. He's part of the 1974 NCAA championship team, class of 1976. Now I will say, According to my dad, Billy could build a house, he could drive a boat, he could do everything.
There was nothing Billy couldn't do.
It's hard to live up to.
Billy, thank you for being here today. It is such an honor to have you and all the players here.
Thank you, Kevin, Kenny. I really didn't have much of a choice when it came down to dealing with your father. And I learned early that you had to do it his way. And the last thing I can remember him saying after a short message is, "You tell them exactly what I said." Of course, I couldn't do that. Good morning. Praise the Lord. I bet the Varsity M Club and the Alumni Association would love to have a turnout like we have here today. Ms. Frazier, Kevin, Kenny, and the entire Frazier family, on behalf of myself, fellow teammates, the Morton community, and thousands of lives that Coach touched, both nationally and abroad, we express our sincere, heartfelt condolences for your loss. Please accept this note of sympathy. No words of sympathy may ease your loss. However, you may find comfort in knowing that thousands of others share in your sorrow. Take a moment and just look around. You know, many of my teammates used to tease me that I was Coach's son. So I could imagine what they're whispering now. We're here to honor and celebrate the life of a great man who was a husband, father, friend, coach, and mentor to many. I am deeply honored and humbled to have the opportunity to speak at the ceremony. I met Coach Frazier as a recruit in late spring, early summer of 1972 in upstate New York. Actually, it was the hub of New York in Westchester County, Elmsford. Other New Yorkers may argue against that. Coach was entering his second year at Morgan State. So we sat down and he methodically went through the material regarding Morgan, starting it with its location and touching on its academic curriculum and sports programs. Subsequent to the completion of our meeting, Coach stated, "Son, I am offering you an opportunity to get a free education, play college basketball, and to explore the black college social experience." Little did he know, he sealed the deal with me when he hesitated a moment and said, "Oh, by the way, you know the ratio to women to men is 13 to 1. In 1971, Coach Frazier departed the University of Illinois to embark on a new career challenge at Morgan. Coach brought along a comprehensive basketball system and a vision. He elected to run his program on the my way or the highway concept. The my way or the highway concept. He was hard but fair. He selected and very carefully recruited high school players, junior college transfers from all walks of life that were products of basketball systems similar to his. His practices were structured, intense, and challenging. In a recent conversation with a teammate of mine, Ivan Young, he noted that Coach provided the most detailed and superb scouting reports. He left no stone unturned. Ivan recalls having this experience during practice, an aspect of defense he just couldn't understand. And it got to the point where Coach was on him and he felt like, this guy's picking on me. Well, after a couple days, Coach Frazier approached him and pulled him aside. And Ivan was re-energized when Coach said, son, as long as I'm talking to you and I'm correcting your mistakes, you don't have anything to worry about. But if I stop, you have big problems. In addition to Ivan's conversation, another teammate of mine, the Reverend Dwayne Sweat, stated that he felt like he was under extreme pressure in practice and on the court. Well, Coach Frazier subtly mounted pressure on all position players by heavily recruiting star quality players year after year. Coach was using the next man up principle back in the 70s. Because if you were in practice and you ran this famous Illinois and the ball went to the wing and you cut under that pick at the top, he would stop practice and say, son, how many times do I have to tell you I want you over the top? There's a reason why I want you over the top. And if you ran the offense again and through rotation you cut underneath, he'd stop practice and say, okay, come on. Somebody get him. Maybe he can learn by watching. And I heard this, there's a reason for going over the top, but how many of you ever found out what the reason was? Another one of my distinguished teammates was Chet Davis. He's the all-conference guard who Coach Frazier inherited when he got the job here. Well, Chet, in conversation with Chet, he expressed his profound love and admiration for Coach Frazier and his nurturing talents. He asserted that it was an honor for him to play under the leadership of Coach Frazier. Chet stated that Coach Frazier was one of the best coaches he had the privilege to play for. He said Coach was a true student of the game. He was a fundamentalist. He knew that defense wins games. He mentally was always setting up his next move. At this time, as quick as it can happen, I would like to respectfully request that all the former players just rise for a quick minute. All the former players. Thank you. This loving, gifted, and legendary man, family man, was blessed with winning the Division II Men's Basketball National Championship in 1974. He earned this accomplishment in 3 years. He was able to achieve his ultimate vision through hard work, organization, persistence. His diligence and competitiveness impacted the lives of all of his players in one way or another. Coach, you will be loved by all, forgotten by few, and remembered for your greatness. You've completed your assignment here on earth, and you're being summoned by the Almighty Power to continue your journey up above. We'll miss you. Rest in peace. God bless you. And we'll see you on the other side. Thank you.
So we're going to keep with the point guard theme, because Nat loved point guard. He really did. And I think they always got special treat a little bit in his system. They
didn't.
You didn't. You didn't. Okay, right. But the others did.
Right.
Quick story. We're playing University of Maryland. And if you know anything about in the 70s, when there were three great teams in the Baltimore, Maryland area, it was University of Maryland, Eastern Shore. They were ranked in the top 20 in the Division I poll. Morgan was ranked number one in the Division II poll, and then there was University of Maryland that had a great team. And I was like, all those times, my father would always say, man, I hope we get a crack at Maryland. We just need, if we get a crack at Maryland, we're going to get them. And so they never got to play him in his first tenure, but when he came back, they did. And we were playing Maryland at Maryland, and it was one of those nights where Nat had locked in and figured out the system. He had figured out the offense. He had figured out the defense, and Maryland was in trouble. And the little contingent of folks from Morgan had the place rocking. And with about a little over a minute to go, Damon Williams came off a little flex cut and turned left, turned right, hit a left-handed jumper off the baseline. And I was like, oh my God, we're gonna beat Maryland. And I looked at Nat and I was like, we're gonna beat Maryland. And I was just like, easy, calm down. But I knew how bad he wanted to beat Maryland. So Maryland went down, scored, but I knew we would get the last shot. And it didn't matter, because we were gonna get the last shot. And Nat had this dialed in. Inbound the ball, and Jason McCoy gets it. He turns up the court, and they call a charging foul. And Maryland gets the ball back, and they hit two free throws, and we lose. Now, I'm looking down at Nat on the bench, because I'm like, it's getting ready to be on in here. And he was calm. And I'm like, how is he so calm? So we go in the locker room. He tells everybody he's so proud of them and how well they played. And I was like, man, if Jason had just looked up and he was like, no, it's okay. A couple of years later, the player who Jason ran over was a guy named Greg Nerit. He ran Nike Golf, and he was the guy who was always with Tiger Woods. And I saw Greg, and I was like, man, you drew that charge. It was amazing. And he said, no. I grabbed Jason's jersey, and I pulled him down to the floor, and the ref missed the call. So I call Nat. I get on the phone. I'm like, he missed the call. But the thing that made Nat proudest was that team and that moment, they came together in a beautiful way. And he was so proud of that moment. He really didn't care that he lost to Maryland because it was a win. Those guys grew up in that moment, and that meant the world to him. And that's what he loved more than wins and losses, believe it or not, are his boys, because he believed in them so much, and Jason was one of those guys.
So that night, I was at that game. I was in military school at the time, and I took the train up, and my friend Kevin Taylor was here, picked me up, and I sat behind that bench. And that was one of the nights that I said, wow, I'd be proud to play for Morgan. And I watched Jason, and I said, oh, that's Bill Newton Jr., and I play point guard. Can I beat him out? I said, but I can advantage. I got the playbooks at home. I can study with my dad all day long. But Jason's always been like a brother to me. He's always been there. When he graduated, he stayed in Howard County, became an educated, well-respected man there. And I was always proud to say, hey, yeah, I know Jason McCoy. He played for my father. He was one of my teammates. He's like my brother. There's days when I would call my dad on the phone. He said, hey, Jason's over here. We're about to go see somebody or go to the mall. And I'm like, okay, that's great. You and Jason. Because he loved Jason.
Yeah.
Jason was always there.
He
brought him down from New York and was like, son, you're going to stay here with me. You're going to be all right. But Jason really meant a lot to him. He was there all the time in the later years. when he was riding around in the Evergreens, Jason was there. So I'd like to introduce Jason McCoy.
I think that was Ural that got the charge. Good morning, everyone. It's certainly an honor to speak on behalf of our beloved coach. Coach really was more than a coach. He was like a father to all of his players and a pillar in the community. And I feel very blessed that I was able to continue my relationship almost on a daily basis with Coach, living right around the corner out in Columbia, and hearing just the why behind a lot of his life lessons that he taught us. Coach was more than a basketball coach. He was a life coach. And all of the players, the lives that he touched, he made us into men. And we were able to then turn and be excellent fathers and community members ourselves. As players, we did not know his tactics, his lectures, the modeling moments, and sometimes he modeled what not to do. But many times it was what to do, and we learned a lot. He helped us to mature from boys to men. And these were life lessons, not basketball lessons. So you heard a lot about how great of a coach he was. He was also a great teacher. And these are some memorable lessons. So Coach knew how to work hard, and you heard about his work ethic, but he sure knew how to play hard. And Coach, if you ever played spades with Coach, he was gonna let you have it. If you ever played checkers with him, if he got to do a double jump, or a triple jump, he was gonna break that checkerboard. He just got so excited. But the classic, in terms of Coach knowing how to play hard as well as work hard, is when he would substitute himself for you during practice. He had the classic line, "Let me be you for a second." And this picture right here represented what he did to us in practice. You see that knee that's up high? That's how he came through the lane. And in practice, those competitive juices would start flowing, and he would just be demonstrating what he wanted out of a play. But then it turned into Nat versus the team, and all of his coaches co-signed for him, and he would start talking stuff. Hey, Larry, watch this. Coach Sweat, Coach Daniels, text. He would get all his coaches hyped. And once he started laughing, and once he took the watch off, you were not coming back into practice. You might as well go sit down. So Coach would very much do everything with us. He not only coached us, but he would get out there and show us. He would demonstrate. He would sit down and eat with us. He traveled with us. He very much made sure we had a family atmosphere. And all of his players are family. And we learn through just Coach's modeling ongoing. We certainly know Coach worked hard. You were having practice whether we had a gym or not. We practiced in the parking lot, in basements, in lobbies. He would move furniture. And his work ethic, he had a plan, and he was going to prepare. And that transferred to us as young men as we had to go into our careers, knowing how important it is to have that work ethic. And Coach would also show us how to have confidence and pride. After every game, win or lose, we circled up as a team, as a family, we held hands. And before we left that floor, even if we were away at another gymnasium, we showed the individuals in that audience how important we were as a family and how we left it on the court. And so he showed us how to have dignity and how to have confidence. And he always focused us on what we had to do in terms of our job. And I remember my freshman year, Stevie Wonder, was in the Fine Murphy Arts, the old building, right across from the gym. We're going to practice, and then we hear Stevie Wonder's here doing an impromptu concert. So we looked at our captains, Troy, Hamp, and who else was it? Who was the other captain? And Lawson. They said, we're going to the concert. I said, well, we have practice. I'm the freshman, and I'm also, you know, I'm coach's point guard. So we ended up going to the concert, everybody except one player. I'm not going to say his name. Coach shows up at practice and sees one player. He didn't come to the auditorium. He didn't come to get us out of the stands. He let us stay for the concert because he treated us like young men, and we had to face the consequence. So at midnight, we had practice in the basement. And that just was how Coach ran his show. There was no talking back. You went down there and you just handled your consequence as a young man. And the classic line that Coach said, Coach has a lot of lines, you know, let me be you for a second. You knew what that meant. He also would say, in reference to Stevie Wonder, Stevie Wonder's doing his thing, and we're doing our thing. And he would say that quite frequently. Coach, they have new uniforms. They're doing their thing, and we're doing our thing. And that's something that, you know, has stayed with me. We're not keeping up with the Joneses. We're not doing this because that looks more attractive. We're going to focus on what we have to do, what our goals and objectives are. And we're going to keep to our task. And so, you know, we never forget that. I never saw Stevie Wonder perform again, so I'm glad I went. But Coach was always a teacher. He always was showing us what was important. And at the time, we didn't realize that. And having the honor of talking with him, you know, 30 years after leaving, after playing with him, I had a better understanding of what he was trying to teach us. Coach gave us a lot of independence on the road. He, again, treated us as young men. He set the expectation. We had an itinerary, right, Larry? Larry would come around and give the itinerary out. If practice said 8 o'clock, if you were not at 8 o'clock, then you got fined. And you had to put money in the kitty. But he treated us as young men, and it taught us responsibility. And we didn't know at the time how he was molding us to be responsible fathers and members of the community. And we so appreciate that now. But on the road, Coach had a famous line, do not get caught in a trick bag. That was his way of saying, don't get in trouble. And going back to the itinerary, Coach had the first seat on the plane, and he was on that plane. He was not knocking on your hotel door to come meet the van. He was not telling you what time to get on the bus. He was on his bus, in his seat, and he knew he set the expectation. And he would tell us all the time, don't get caught in the trick bag. So Coach really kept us focused on what we had to do. And I love Coach as a father, as a mentor, and I really thank Mrs. Frazier, Kevin, and Kenny for sharing Coach with us. They never had a problem with Coach loving all of his players as if our last name was Frazier. So today we honor him, we celebrate him, and we thank you for coming out. God bless.
Nat and Jason, they all over Columbia. You know, it's funny because I sometimes feel like my father was Dr. Phil, too.
At least he thought he was.
Or at least he thought he was. He loved Dr. Phil, and he would do things that would make you wonder, what in the world is he thinking? And we were at Florida A&M. And first half, we're playing Florida A&M, and things are going okay. But for some reason, I think I saw Jermaine come in here. Jermaine and Jason aren't talking to each other. And so I'm like, what's going on? I'm asking him, what's going on? Why are they going at it? What's the matter? So halftime comes and we go up into this classroom and Coach comes in and he comes in and he's like, Everybody get in a circle. So we're like, get in a circle? He's like, you get in a circle. So we all get in a circle. He's like, make sure you get tight, get in a circle. Everybody gets in a circle. He's like, Jermaine and Jason, get in the middle circle. And now I'm like, what's going on? He's like, no, y'all got a problem? Let's fight now. Hurry up and fight. We only got a few minutes. We only got a few minutes until the end of halftime. Y'all hurry up and fight. And I'm like, what? And I'm looking at Mike Corley. I think it was Mike Corley. I was like, I don't know. Listen, I don't know. But the interesting thing is, they looked at each other, and then Coach said a few interesting words, and then he said, shake hands. Can we go out and play basketball? We know what we're supposed to do. And they went out and played basketball, and they beat Florida A&M that day. And I never forget that at some point, I looked down the court. Here's Jason getting, some dude bumped Jermaine, and Jason standing over the dude like, don't touch my man or else you're going to have a problem with me. But that was the kind of guy that he was. And the most unorthodox, crazy things seemed to work. He also, to me, was like a superhero. And when people ask me when I see all these famous people, do I get nervous? I was like, the heroes that I met were these guys, these players. That's who we grew up talking about around our dinner table. These were the people that I went to practice and I listened to stories about and all the great things they did. And I just feel that everyone should have someone believe in them as much as Nat believed in his ball players, as much as he believed in his family, and as much as he believed in all his friends. He loved people, and it meant the world to him to have you all around. He's going to be missed, but I'm sure. I just want to give a few instructions to the folks up in heaven. Number one, check his pockets if he's golfing with you, because he'll carry an extra golf ball. When he's playing cards, watch out, because he'll get you now. But as a father, he is the person that made me want to be a father, and he's the person that makes me love my children every single day because of the places he took me and the things he allowed me to do. He allowed us to be on the court, on the bench with him when we were little kids, and he would talk to us during the game. Literally, he might say some crazy things to the official, and then he'd turn around and he'd say, Kevin, we're going to run rotation. I want you to watch how we run off this guard. Watch what's going to happen. And then he'd turn around and start screaming at the ref again or one of the players. But it was a beautiful thing, and that is something that never leaves you when someone believes in you like that. And that's why I'll miss the FaceTimes and I'll miss the calls. I'll miss him checking in, like, where are you? I didn't see you on the show today. And I was like, just traveling. I still got my job. I'll miss those calls, but I always will be waiting to see him on the other side. He's the greatest man I ever knew, and I'll love him forever.
So one thing we forgot to mention is that same year, I played for my father. My brother was assistant coach. Imagine that dynamic. But it just brought us all together and we got so much closer because the days, when I first came to Morgan, the days that we would come to practice, I would go home. And if you know my dad, he'd probably have Kwame playing on his tape. He'd have a Fig Newton probably in the back because he didn't eat enough today, so he needs his sugar. And he would talk to me about the plays. And all day and night, we'd talk about plays. We'd go home, we'd watch other colleges play. We'd go home, we'd watch professional players play. And he just wanted to teach us a lot. I want to tell you just one or two things that people might not know about my father. Some of the players here know, but he is the grand champion of Miss Pac-Man. So if you've ever been to my house, you got challenged, okay? He liked Westerns. As a little kid, I had to watch Westerns with him. He liked racing. He'd always watch the Indy 500. For hours, he watched the cars go around, and he loved golf. But most of all,
golf.
Yeah, he tried. He'll tell you he was a scratch golfer, but I doubt that was true. But most of all, he really just cared about people. And if I could leave everyone here with just one thing about him, he'd want you just to pass it on to somebody else. Take care of somebody else's kid. Help a kid get through school. Help somebody who's down. Reach out, because I think basketball was just his vehicle to teach people, But at the end of the day, that's what he was here for, to all make us better people. He had his own ways and tactics, and we all know it, but that was his goal.
Yeah, right now we're gonna bring our mom out. She has a poem that she wants to read. And I also wanna remind everybody that we have a lot of food over at the Student Center at the repast. Please come over and eat and enjoy and tell stories. And I also want everybody to take pictures together now that we're together here. But right now, I mean, when you're married to someone for more than 55 years, you learn. And no one also, I mean, if he was a psychologist, then she was a super psychologist because she had to deal with that. She dealt with that dude.
Good afternoon. And I want to thank each one of you for all the support that you have given our family and also for coming and showing your presence. And I have to say that I've been on this roller coaster since 62. So we've had a lot of ups and a lot of downs. I mean, almost really downs, and then a lot of ups. And we celebrated, and I think I want to say thanks to all of you. I also feel like I have two boys and like five grandchildren, but I had a multitude of children right here in Baltimore. Thanksgiving dinner for 20, when they have to go to a tournament, well, who's gonna give them dinner? So, of course, Alice, you have to start planning this dinner. I did get out of that a new microwave oven because I got up at 2 o'clock in the morning to put the second turkey in because the first turkey had just finished. But we had a great dinner, and not only one time, but for many days. And many days we had to provide for other people and other children. But I really want to say thank you. Before I read this poem, I got this poem from a lady while I was doing my father's going home program. And I just couldn't find anyone that says exactly what I wanted to say. So this one does. It's in your program, so you can also take it home and someday maybe pick it up. Miss me, but let me go. When I come to the end of the day and the sun has set for me, I want no rights in a gloom-filled room. Why cry for a soul set free? Miss me a little, but not too long, and not with your head bowed down low. Remember the love that we once shared. Miss me, but let me go. For this is a journey that we all must take, and each must go alone. It is all part of the Master's plan, a step on a road to home. When you are lonely and sick of heart, go to a friend we know. Bury your sorrows in doing good deeds. Miss me, but let me go. I think there's one person that had known and dealt with Nat longer than I have, and that's his roommate and teammate at Tuskegee. Okay.
By and by, when the morning comes, oh, all the saints of God to carry me home, we will tell the story how we overcome, and we'll understand it better by and by. Oh, by and by. Oh, when the morning comes, all the saints of God to carry me, I will tell the story how we overcome, and we'll understand it better by and by. Give God some praise in here. Amen, 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 amen. God has taken, I won't say our friend, but one who has been all of our friend. There is a time that we must depart, but God can heal all empty hearts. And I come by just for briefly to say to you that I am blessed to have had Nat Frazier to cross my path in my life. So I say to you, my dear friend, I do have a disclaimer. And I might take all day. That might be the disclaimer. But I want to celebrate with you here this morning, afternoon, that trouble don't last always. It is here for us. Nat Frazier, I met him in 1954. At Tuskegee Institute. I went down to Tuskegee. They had a 5-year program, and some of you from Tuskegee here might know that you can work your way through school. But Nat came from Afford Beach High School in Savannah. He and Zeke Williams with a full scholarship. Coach didn't even know me. That wanted to know where I was from and was where I was from. I said, Eastman, Georgia. He said, is it on the map? But I used to walk by the music hall every day, and there was this song that I heard that brought me together with Tuskegee and our long relationship. Over my head, I hear music in the air. Over my head, I hear music in the air. Over my head, I hear music in the air. There must be a God somewhere. I heard that under Dr. Dawson, William Dawson, and they were getting ready to go to New York to Radio City Hall to sing, and we used to have to go by there, Nat and I, to Tompkins Hall to eat. But to make this story long and short, Nat was my best man at my wedding. And I got my wife here tonight, today, to prove it that he was. And I got him right here to prove it too, that he was. She said Nat was laughing all the time. The preacher was saying, asking me, was I do, not care. I said, no, he just happy. Nat is happy that way. And so from 1954, even up to the other day, 65 years of friendship and relationship. I got 45 volumes that has been sealed that I'm not going to release today. But I'm going to tell you a few things here, how he has impressed me, because I saw Nat in a different way. All the very good things that you have said, all the what you have done and here. Yes, life throws us a curveball. We did not expect it to happen to Nat like this, and yet we all know that as God's children, we one day going to hear that call, that very call, say, come home to me, that I'm ready for you. I've got your mansion already prepared. But we are not prepared in our hearts to hear that story from him. But Nat did go. Something unusual happened here. Two unusual things have happened here today. One, Nat, I heard, died at 3 o'clock. And do you know that Jesus gave up the ghost at 3 o'clock? Because he was ready to go. And I believe Nat was ready to go. The next thing that happened here this day is that the scripture of the New Testament that was read was what 2 Timothy 4:7-8. I base my sermon off of that in Atlanta, Georgia. Didn't talk to them about what they were going to have, a bishop, but it happened this way. And you have heard it, that I am what? Fought a good fight. I've finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me. Hallelujah. And listen to what he say. Unto all of them, all of them that love his appearance. Paul was not selfish. If I got a crown, I want you to have a crown. If I win the game, you win the game. If I get something, you will have something. Nat was that kind of person. And I saw him through the prisms of poems that even his wife Alice read. Alice came to Tuskegee to see Nat one day, and he introduced me to her. And I say, that's your girlfriend? He said, yeah. And I said, where's she from? Charleston. I said, how is the heck a Geechee gonna marry a Gullah girl? But y'all see, and it's lasted 61 years. We've been married for 61 years. This woman right here, don't tell nobody. That's why Nat stood. Let me go on. Because Nat, to me, was cast through the eyes of Benjamin E. Mays when he said, I have only just 1 minute, 60 minutes, 60 seconds in it, forced upon me, can't be refused, didn't seek it, didn't choose it, but it's up to me to use it. I must suffer if I lose it, give an account if I abuse it, just a tiny little minute, but eternity is in it. Nat, I want to talk about the greatness, the destiny of greatness of this man that we have celebrated here today and will continue to celebrate. Nat, to me, caught me off guard one day, and I said, Nat, what is it that you do? Well, Nat, I asked him. He said, well, man, I just go talk to him. So I just, you know, and I tell him what I want him to know. Because I'm from Beach High. Beach. Alfred Beach. Y'all know where that is. Savannah, you know. And when I told him that my grandmother was from Savannah, I said, man, this is a good thing, you know. Because my grandmother raised me a little bit and taught me a little bit. So we got in a fight one day. I know you see me jumping around here, okay? We had a pickup game of three and there at Tuskegee, and the guys wanted to fight us. We were beating those guys so bad they was losing their shoes, okay? And the guy came up to me and said, man, you better stop driving on me and hitting me like that, and I boned him, you know? And the guy come up to me to fight me. He said, man, you gonna fight? That's what Nat asked him, you gonna fight? I said, Nat, yeah, he gonna fight. Man, we with you, man. That's what he told me. And Zeke Williams, James Williams, said, yeah, man, we're with you, man. You know, I said, well, man, and I heard that before. I said, I got a friend now. Nat Frazier is my friend. And let me tell you one other thing about Nat. Nat is like what Kipling says he is. If you can talk with the crowd and keep your virtue, or walk with kings, now lose the common touch. If neither foreign or loving friends can hurt you, if all men count you but none of them too much, if you can fill the unforgiving minute with 60 seconds worth of distant run, yours is the earth and everything that it is, and which is more, you be a man, my son. He was already in that vein of running and can talk with kings and talk with people high in the echelon of life, and doctors and lawyers and governors and all that kind of folks, and come to your house and sit on your front porch, eat your black-eyed peas and collard greens and rice and everything, and drink your tea, and be just as common as he was with a bow tie on with them downtown. That's the common kind of person that Nat Frazier showed to me. Another way that Nat showed to me is in the Psalm of Life, which is under Longfellow. Longfellow said, lives of great men all remind us we can make our lives sublime, and departing leaves behind us footprints on the sand of time. Footprints that perhaps another sail, O life, solemn main, forlorn and shipwrecked brother, seeing shall take heart again. Let us be up and then be doing, but with the heart for any fate, still achieving, still pursuing, learn to labor and to wait. Nat had this concept because he was destined for greatness. Well, finally, as I close, this musician here played the song so well, I started to get up and try to beat him out in singing it. Mahalia Jackson, her arrangement, If I Can Help Somebody. If you ever known Nat Frazier, and I try to sum up what everybody has said, if I can help somebody, as I pass along, if I can cheer somebody with the word of song, if I can show somebody what that he's traveling wrong, then my living will not be in vain. Then Nat goes on and say, if I can do my duty as a good man ought, if I can bring back beauty to the world of wrought, if I can spread love messages as the master taught, then my living will not be in vain. My living will not be in vain. And Nat said, I've run this race, I've fought a good fight, and what's for me is a crown up in heaven. I'm not boasting, but I'm teaching Timothy that you got to fight, you got to run this race, you got to preach in season and out of season, you got to tell them that Jesus died on the cross, you got to let them know you're covered by the blood, and one day when your fight is over, when your running is over, your crown will be waiting for you. Nat, your crown is there waiting for you. God bless you.
One more time, can you put your hands together for this awesome eulogist? You're talking about 65 years of friendship. I thank God that we didn't hear all of the stories that happened with basketball players who were roommates back then. I came here to Morgan, and I know what basketball players did. Praise the Lord for all of you in their dorm rooms. All right, so... But while we are celebrating the life of this loved one, I think it would be fitting before we finish this service, if you could do me this great favor, 57 years of marriage. Why don't you stand to your feet and let's honor God and thank God for this wonderful woman and put your hands together for Alice Frazier, who has been by his side all of these years. I think it's awesome. Amen. When we have marriages lasting 72 days, we're grateful for 57 years. At this time, those sons are coming back. Kevin and Kenny, give them a hand.
As we you know, that we were thinking about who would be the pallbearers, and there's no one better than the men who played for him. So we want the basketball players to come up because, I mean, if he's going to leave Morgan, he's going to leave with y'all because you're the people who meant the most to him. So if you all could come up and come down here. And the gentlemen. Of course, Nat's brother Neely, right there in the front. Neely, who played here at Morgan. Everybody, come on down, and we're gonna go ahead and we're gonna take the casket out with their help. Pool. Man, it's so good to see all y'all. I want all y'all to make sure that you please come over to the repast so we can take pictures, and it's so good to see everybody together. Okay, and afterwards, then we will head over to the student center on the second floor. We'll have repasts and lots of food and lots of memories about Coach.
Now may the saving grace of our once crucified Lord rest, rule, and abide with us now and forever. In Jesus' name, amen.
Get to heaven. Just wanna cross the river. I just wanna be free. from sin. And I just want my name to be written hear him say, well done. Just want to hear him say, oh, yeah. Say,